finally tonight, an international art exhibition aims to create a new portrait of New Orleans. Jeffrey Brown has our report.
Through layers of slime, a trumpet is raised. A trombone pokes out, and you can almost hear the sounds of New Orleans. These photographs once documented the vibrant life of this city. Now they capture something else, the destruction wrought by Katrina.
But they're not photos anymore, they're objects now. The water took it to another level.
Keith Calhoun and Chandra McCormick are married and professional photographers who've been documenting their city for 30 years. When Katrina came, their lower Ninth Ward home and much of their work was destroyed.
We had the pressure wash and that several times and treated.
And the couple and their children left for Texas. Now they're back as part of an effort to restore their neighborhood and city through art. L9, their new home base, is part art gallery, part community center.
We see the space as a light for the community. What we're doing here at L9, as artists, we're taking our space. We have art, we got painters coming in, we have photographers, filmmakers, people who just want to come and help. So we're going to make sure that we have a space that's valuable in the community.
We needed a space for ourselves to stay visible because what we do makes us whole. It just seems right that art can help rebuild, art can heal.
In the area where the couple once again lives and works, there are some signs of life and rebuilding. You drive down almost any street here, and it's clear that more than 3 years later, this is a community mostly gone or in exile. Citywide, the population is some 25% to 30% lower than before Katrina. The notion that art can heal and be part of the rebirth of New Orleans is being tested in a big way right now through Prospect One, an exhibition of contemporary art that's billed as the largest of its kind ever held in the U.S., with works by some 80 artists from around the world on display at sites throughout the city. Some address Katrina directly, like Los Angeles-based artist Mark Bradford's Ark, made of plywood and tattered posters on an abandoned site in the lower Ninth Ward. And Japanese sculptor Takeshi Horisaki's ghost-like reconstruction of a destroyed home on display in an old warehouse downtown.
I didn't really set out with a conscious framework of how many venues or where. But what I wanted to do was make sure that the whole city was involved.
You can see him.
The man behind Prospect One is Dan Cameron, a veteran international curator. He began coming to New Orleans in the 70s for Jazz Fest and ended up making it a second home. Then came Katrina.
You were clear from the start that this was about helping the city as much as putting on an art exhibition.
Exactly. I had kind of reached my limit of seeing disaster footage. And I thought, well, why can't we create a new symbol for this city, something along the lines of Jazz Fest, which is known around the world as a cultural celebration and something which brings hundreds of thousands of people to the city with a lot of goodwill and some money in their pockets.
Cameron raised almost $4 million, mostly through private foundations and donors, and conceived of the exhibition as a biennial to be held every 2 years, like those that grabbed the art world's attention in Venice, Sao Paulo, and other major cities. He wanted and got a number of contemporary stars to get it off the ground quickly, but he was also eager to include local artists.
There are artists here in the city, and they lost their homes and their life's work as well. Art maybe seems to some people as a luxury, as a secondary need of life. If you're involved in art vocationally, that's not true. Art is your lifeblood.
I can remember the first time I came, it was called Delgado Museum then, and I was 11 years old. And before that, African Americans weren't allowed in the museum.
Willie Birch is one of New Orleans' best-known artists. Born and raised here, he spent years in New York, but returned in 1997. In Prospect One, his work has a place of honor in the grand foyer of what is now called the New Orleans Museum of Art.
You love this juxtaposition of these columns and your work looking at the street.
Right.
Why?
Well, it's bringing my world inside of a place where traditionally we haven't seen much of what's in my community.
Birch's multi-paneled, large-scale drawings capture scenes and tell stories from his 7th Ward community.
The best art is always layered, and it's layered in a way that it reveals story upon story. So you may come in and see a picture or a group of images, but once you get beyond that particular veil, you find that there are other stories that are there.
Prospect 1 also honors local culture with the Mardi Gras suits of Victor Harris, also at the New Orleans Museum of Art. Harris, the big chief of the New Orleans Mardi Gras Indian tribe Fayayay, makes one of these a year for the annual celebration.
These are ledgers.
A rather different image of New Orleans is captured in the work of Deborah Luster, another local artist, whose photographs are on view at the Louisiana State Museum in the old U.S. Mint. Black and white ovals, these are city scenes that have an almost nostalgic cast to them, until you learn that each is the site of a recent homicide. In what remains a violent city, Luster wants to show the darkness alongside the beauty.
I think everyone knows there's this other side of New Orleans, but we become numb. And I guess showing it in another way, in another context, opens people's eyes to the subject again.
Of course, this is probably not the image that city officials want visitors to take away from the exhibition. Councilwoman Stacy Head's district includes a number of Prospect 1 sites, including the Contemporary Arts Center.
This is one of the silver linings to the cloud of Katrina. The fact that we are having so many tourists come to New Orleans, so many art lovers come to New Orleans to be part of this initial Prospect 1 event is very good for our local economy. And what it tells them is we are a city where you've got two stories. You've got one story of incredible resilience where we have Prospect 1, but we also have horrible needs still in the community. And it's really hard to get that message out.
Dan Cameron had a goal of 100,000 visitors before the exhibition closes in mid-January. Even though it's all free, the economic slump is holding down the number of outside visitors. On a recent weekend, though, the L9 Gallery was a hub of activity, with people coming and going.
Okay, guys.
A sign of progress amid the destruction, with the hope of things to come. Cameron is working on Prospect 2 now and has committed to see this through to 2016.
Jeffrey Brown joins me in the studio now to describe an exciting new addition to the online NewsHour. So, tell us all about it. What's involved here?
Well, Judy, this is kind of an exciting thing we're doing online as opposed to what we do in pieces like that on the show. We're creating an art beat on the NewsHour online, where every night, every day, we're going to add news stories, we're going to have feature stories, and we're going to have a weekly interview that I'll conduct with somebody from the world of arts. Some of this is the kind of thing that continuing what we've been doing in the past. So, for example, that piece that we just aired, as we have in the past, if people want to see more about that piece, they can go online. That interview I did with Dan Cameron, the curator there, of course, we can only use a little bit of it in the piece, right? But there's a lot more to it. We're putting more of it online. If people are interested and want to know more, they can go and hear that. There's a slideshow with more of the art. So some of it is what we've been doing, a continuation. But what's exciting is that we get to do a lot more arts web only. So only on the internet, not what appears on the program.
So give us some more examples of what kinds of things people can find.
Well, we're going to be looking at a lot of different kind of art forms, as always. You know, so books and movies and art exhibitions. We put together a little a short tape reel that has a few examples. These are short clips from three things. Two of them are already going to be up today, one later in the week. So let me just explain before we look at it. One is an exhibition of the artist Saul LeWitt at the Massachusetts Museum of Contemporary Art, MassMoCA, in North Adams, Massachusetts. One of our colleagues did an interview with the curator. We put together a kind of a slideshow narrated by the curator and much else. The next little snippet we'll see is an interview I did with the Egyptian novelist Ala al-Aswani, who is one of the, probably in the Arab world, he is the leading bestseller among novelists and getting quite a bit of attention here. And the third thing is a clip from the Soweto Gospel Choir, which we'll have later in the week on our site. We just have a little clip here of them performing. But this is a group that just won a Grammy nomination for its work and is touring the country. So why don't we look at that clip now?
Now, I think what's amazing about this 40-year body of work of his, of almost 1,300 works, is just how much innovation and play and sheer variety of beauty one could get from combining line, color, and then the other thing he worked into is his concepts with the notion of geometric forms and then ultimately isometric forms, the representing geometric forms sort of volumetrically, but always flat on the wall.
We had before 9/11 this kind of, you see, misunderstanding between cultures and different people and the stereotypes, etc. But now it is pushed on the surface. And I believe that literature has been all the time a wonderful tool to get rid of the stereotypes.
Well, so those are a few examples. Later in the week, there'll be other things, including a conversation I just taped today with Cleve Jones, who's one of the people behind the new movie Milk. We're going to about Harvey Milk, the gay activist. We're going to start slowly and see what we can do. We might experiment with some things, even like a book club, where we invite viewers to join us, read a book, send in their questions, and I'll host an interview with the author.
Very cool. Now, I think I know the answer to this, Jeff, but why did you do this?
Well, two important things come out of this. One, continues our commitment to the arts. I hope viewers know how much we care about that here. It's a long tradition at the NewsHour, something I'm extremely proud to be part of. We really care about trying to get it on as part of a news program. Of course, there are limits every night to how much we can do. This is a new way of doing it. The second is it shows our commitment to online. The online NewsHour is growing leaps and bounds. It's not just about the arts. So I hope people know, but I'll remind them that you can go there every night. You can see all kinds of things. We have something called World View about international coverage.
And the address is?
The address is pbs.org/newshour.
Very cool stuff. Jeff Brown, thank you very much.
Thanks, Judy.
Okay.